Good morning, sons. Lovely Sunday morning. And what a privilege it is for us to gather again around the Word of God and just to continue in our studies on still lesson 3 of Apostolic People, with a specific focus on the characteristics of an apostolic son. Really meditating upon these things that cause us to be accurate in our representation of our sonship as sons of God. What I want to share with you this morning is I'm still continuing in talking to you on the authority and the reality of the Word of God. And I decided that for our time of meditation this morning, I want to look at some of the examples that we find in Scripture where we see that a true son really lives from the Word of God. And also as part of that, we see how Paul gave instructions to his spiritual son, Timothy, in the importance of living life from the Word of God. Now, over the past 2 weeks, I have been speaking to you on the importance of having the Word of God as your focus and of your as your reality. I also encouraged you to focus on the practical application of the Word in all aspects of your life and to live your life from that place and from that position. Now, this morning I want to speak to you on the perspectives of living your life from the doctrine that you receive from the grace carrier that God has placed in your life. And as an example, I want us to look at the life of Paul and Timothy in their relationship of the wineskins of father and son. So I want to start off with the reading in 1 Timothy 4, verse 1 to 16. I know it's quite a long portion, but I pray that you will really just bear with me as we quickly read through this portion of Scripture. In 1 Timothy 4, verse 1 to 16, it says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. If you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed, but reject profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourself towards godliness. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, for to this end we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially those who believe." Excuse me. "These things command and teach. Let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, and in purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you. I want to try and do, and I'm really going to try, a line upon line interpretation of these scriptures in emphasizing some of the aspects that Paul addresses with Timothy. I also understand that I will not be able to do this fully and completely, so please, guys, just bear with me. But I want to start off with 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 and 2, where it says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons." Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. I've never before seen such an influx of exactly this in this time of lockdown. Giving heed to deceiving spirits, doctrines of demons. All of a sudden, the rapture theory is rampant over all the social media. Deceiving spirits, all this nonsense about conspiracies and all the conspiracy theories that's going around. Conscience that is being seared because it becomes callous because of partaking in things that we are not and should not partake of. So I want to speak to your sons and say this is really, really a very dangerous time for you as sons and as believers, and it is very easy to get distracted in this time of lockdown in doing things that are not fruitful for your spiritual life and walk with God. It is so easy to become passive in this time and waste your time watching TV and stream movies all day and even play online computer games or physical computer games instead of buying out the time in studying the word and the doctrine of what we are releasing in this time. It is also a dangerous time because you are locked into one house, one roof over your heads, there's no space. So everything that is matters of the heart will begin to manifest and reveal itself. Relationships will become strained because the self, the carnal nature in you will begin to manifest. I don't know, and I don't care how holy you are. And this is why this message of living your life from the Word of God is such an important aspect. We cannot allow ourselves to be distracted in this time. Now, I want you to turn your attention to 1 Timothy 4, verse 13. Now, the first aspect of this scripture in 1 Timothy 4, verse 13, that I want to emphasize is where he says, give attention. And then he describes what needs to be given attention to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine. The truth of the matter is that sadly, most ministries and churches today are built on entertainment, on personality, crowd gathering events, gimmicks, programs, and many other things that simply appeals to the flesh of man. But a truly biblical minister will build solely on the Word of God. Now, in this letter that Paul writes to Timothy, it is very clear that until he returns to meet with Timothy, Timothy was to do one thing only. And we see that in 2 Timothy 2 verse 2. He says, "And the things that you have heard from me amongst many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." He was instructing Timothy to keep preaching the truth in which Paul had instructed him. Now, this phrase in verse 13 that we've read that says give attendance or give attention, depending on the translation that you use, is a translation from the word, Greek word prosichu, which carries the meaning of a nautical term for holding a ship in a specific direction. So it actually speaks about the rudder of a ship in order to sail onwards. Now, if you look at the definition of this word prosichu, to take heed or to give attendance or attention to, it means to hold the mind and the ear towards someone. And we know who that someone is. That is God himself. It also means to pay attention. And as I said to you, it means to keep steering a ship by the rudder. It means for us that we need to hold course. So the whole concept in this scripture where Paul is speaking to Timothy deals with this principle of to hold on one's course. And as I said to you, that the course that Timothy was to hold according to Paul was not entertainment or meeting people's felt needs. His cause was to be the word of God alone. We see Paul using this very same word, prosichu, in his letter in the book of Titus, when he was writing a letter to Titus, in Titus 1 verse 14, where he says, "Not giving heed," and again the word heed here is the word prosichu, "to Jewish fables and commandments of men who turn from the truth." Now, Jewish fables were actually a mixture of extra-biblical Jewish traditions and pagan myths. And there's so much of that going around today, like the rapture and the mark of the beast and all those other things that we constantly are hearing about. Now, similarly, when it speaks about the commandments of men, it actually refers to man-made teachings. You must wear a suit when you go to church. Women should not wear pants. You know, it's those kind of things. And Paul told Titus that he was not to set his course, his direction, according to those things, but he must align himself according to God's word. And I really believe this is a hard word from God to the church in this day, in this season in which we are living. Because if we look at today's methods and traditions that we are following and we're doing, and we have the audacity to call that church. Specifically, Timothy's and Titus's progression and manner of life was to be set out and be focused on reading, on exhortation and doctrine, and by application. This should be your course and my course as believers as well. It's very interesting that the definite article appears before the word reading, which indicates the specific practice of public reading. And because of the scarcity of manuscripts in that time, we see the practice of reading and explaining scripture taking place in the synagogue. I'm just going to give you some scriptures, and I must tell you, my journey of doing the research and listening and studying this, I was amazed to see at how many places in scripture this is actually taking place. And I've just kind of read over it and never, the penny never dropped for me. In Acts 15 verse 21, it says, "For Moses has had throughout many generations those who preach him in every city being read in the synagogues every Sabbath." It was a culture. Luke 4 verse 16. "So he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was," in other words, a culture, "he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read." We see here that it was even Jesus was practicing this in his ministry. As a direct result, we also see this practice being carried into the early church. In Colossians 4 verse 16, it says, "Now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea." In 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 27, it says, "I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read to all the holy brethren." So we can see how this pillar of apostolic doctrine became so established in the early church. First and foremost, it was the reading of God's word that was taken priority in the early church. And therefore, it is something that needs to also take priority in our modern day church and the way that we do church. That should be our course of action, to bring alignment and bring the word of God back into the place of priority in our households, and not the other paraphernalia that we love so much and what we call church. I suggest that you take the time to meditate and study the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8 from verse 1. Up until verse 8. And just for completeness sake, I will quickly read this portion of scripture to you. And I'm reading it from the New King James Version. It says in verse 1 from Nehemiah 8, "Now all the people gathered together as one man in the open square that was in the front of the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. So Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of men and women, and all who could hear with understanding, and on the first day of the seventh month. And then he read from it in the open square that was in front of the water gate, from morning until midday, before the men and women and those who could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. So Ezra the scribe stood on a platform of wood, which they had made for the purpose, and beside him at his right hand stood Mattithiah, Shema, Ananiah, Urijah, Hilkiah, Maaseiah, and at his left hand Pedaiah, Mishael, Malchijah, Hashum, Hashbadana, Zechariah, and Meshulah. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. Then all the people answered, Amen, Amen, while lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground." And then he mentions all those names again in verse 7. "And all these people helped the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place." Verse 8, "So they read distinctly from the book in the law of God, and they gave the sense and helped them to understand the reading." So if you study this portion of scripture, you will see that there was so much emphasis placed upon the reading of the word, the respect of the word that was shown, and how the scriptures was explained by those that stood around Ezra in helping him so that people can understand the word of God. I really want you to take note of the position and the importance that was given in Nehemiah to the reading of the word, and also in the New Testament scriptures that I've shared with you. It continues further, and I want to say to you, if you are the father of a household, and I don't mean whether you are a spiritual father, yes, that of course, that's a given. But if you are the father of a house, and you've got a wife and children, there's a very specific demand that is placed upon fathers of households. We see this scripture here in Acts 20, verse 27 and 28. It says, "For I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God." Verse 28, it says, "Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all of the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God which he purchased with his own blood." Now the word here in verse 28 that says, "take heed," is the very same word, prosichu, that I said to you earlier, it means to hold the mind or the ear towards someone. So there's a definite desire to hear. In Jeremiah 7, verse 23 to 24, it says, "But this is what I commanded them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people, and walk in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well with you. Yet they did not obey or incline their ear, but followed the counsels and the dictates of their evil hearts and went backwards and not forward." I said to you that incline your ear is to pay attention. It means to hold the ship in a specific direction, to sail towards a specific destination. But we also need to understand that this word prosichu in the New Testament is used in a figurative way, which means then that we need to apply our mind to something, to attend to it, and to give heed to it. So the word here is very clear that God's instruction for us is to give attention to his word, to take heed of his word, to make it our focus, and to align ourselves to his word. And as a leader or as a mature believer, you have the responsibility to function and to operate from this way. We can no longer treat the word of God lightly and superficially. I am very frustrated to a certain extent in my dealings with some people outside of the household that have listened to my messages where I speak about the reality of the word, but still treats the word of God lightly and do not align themselves to the word of God. And I tell you, we really need grace from God in order to live our lives in this way and in this manner. Now, the second part of that instruction to Timothy was the word exhortation that was used. And the word exhortation in the Greek is the word paraklesis. And let's again look at what was Paul's command to Timothy. Let's go back to 1 Timothy 4, verse 13. It says, "Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine." Not only did Paul instruct Timothy to set his course on the reading of the scriptures, but he also told him that he needs to practice exhortation. Now, the Greek word paraklesis refers to admonition or encouragement for the purpose of strengthening and establishing the believer in the faith. So the whole purpose of the word, and for us to use the word, apply the word, meditate on the word, and the why and of the reasons why I as a father is continuously if you want to call it, hammering you with the word, and to your greatest frustration sometimes, is because I'm trying to exhort you, to admonish you, to encourage you for the strengthening and establishing of faith in your life as a believer, that the Word of God can truly become your only reality and authority. In Romans 15 verse 4, it says, "For whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope." That's, in this time, we need the Word. We need to have that patience and comfort that the scripture gives to us, that the scripture brings hope to us. Because if God tells us in his Word, "I will never leave you and I will never forsake you in the midst of your trials and your tribulations," it gives us hope. We have faith to endure. We have faith to push through the crisis that we are facing. In Philippians 2 verse 1, it says, "Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy," it's all about the Word bringing comfort, affection, fellowship in the Holy Spirit. Hebrews 12 verse 5 says, "And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons." And then it says, "My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him." A father disciplines his children. Hebrews 13:22 says, "And I appeal to you, brethren, bear with the word of exhortation, for I have written to you in few words." You see here, Paul speaks of his preaching of the gospel, and he uses the word paraklesis, and we see it in the following scriptures. 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 3, it says, "For our exhortation did not come from error or uncleanness, nor was it in deceit." Acts 13:15, "And after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them, saying, Men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on." 2 Corinthians 8 verse 4, "Imploring us with much urgency that we should receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints." And then 2 Corinthians 8 verse 16 and 17, "But thanks be to God who puts the same earnest care for you into the heart of Titus, for he not only accepted the exhortation, but being more diligent, he went to you of his own accord." So if I kind of summarize all of this, I want to say, in short, exhortation is the application of the exposition of the Word. It challenges you as sons and others as God's people to obey the truth of God's Word, and then also bring warning of the consequences if we do not submit ourselves to the Word of God. It's very interesting that most of us tend to view the word exhortation as a negative word, but the word paraklesis is actually translated as the words also of comfort and of consolation many times in the New Testament. In Romans 15 verse 4 and 5, it says, "For whatever things were written before were written for our learning," I've just read it to you earlier, "that we through the patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Now may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded towards one another according to Christ Jesus." You see, we are struggling with being of one heart and one mind. And this is the problem, because we don't get our exhortation from the scripture. We need to ask ourselves this question: what really brings comfort and consolation to me? Does this modern day popular psychology that people are bring it, sprouting forth, is that giving us comfort? Does some little cliche or clever saying bring consolation to us? No. But what truly brings comfort to the troubled heart and consolation to the mind that is confused of a person is the word of God. You know, it amazes me. I've been in so many places where people are facing trials and tribulations. I've been in so many places where people have lost loved ones that has died or has gotten terminally ill. You know what is the most amazing thing? Many of these people are not believers. They don't love Jesus. They are not committed believers. The amazing thing is, you can give them scripture in that moment and in that time. It consoles them. It comforts them. They grab hold onto that. And they clean forget that they, a week or two ago, said, I don't believe in any God. There is no God. That is the power that there is in the word of God. There's a marvelous occurrence of this paraclesis that appears when Paul and his party went to Antioch in Pisidia. In Acts 13, verse 15, it says, and after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them, saying, men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. They were invited to preach. In the verses that follow from verse 16 up until verse 52, it recounts to us the story how Paul preached on that day. And on even on the following week, on the Sabbath, he reviewed in the process some of Israel's history. He spoke about David and that through him the Savior, the Lord Jesus, came. And then preached that only through Jesus is there forgiveness of sins. Let me read to you the last two verses there. It says, not the last two, but verses 38 and 39 of Acts 13, it says, therefore let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins, referring to Jesus. And by him everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. If you study this chapter, you have to ask yourself, what was the outcome of this? What is the result? The result was, of course, chaos. But while this caused conflict amongst most of the Jews, which resulted in Paul being expelled from that region, you can see that in Acts 13, verse 15, many of the Gentiles were glad, and they glorified the word of the Lord, and as many as were ordained to eternal life believed. Check out verse 48 and 49. It says also that the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. And what is there more comfort bringing? What does bring more comfort than the reality and the truth that we have the ability to know that in Christ our sins are forgiven? There's another word that I want us to look at this morning, and that is the word exhort or the word beseech. And the Greek word for that is parakaleo, and it's a very similar word to that of paraklesis. The word parakaleo is basically two words that is combined. Para, that means beside, and kaleo, that means to call. So if you put those two together, you get the meaning of the word that means to call alongside. Originally, it spoke of summoning someone and at times to summon to one's aid for help or encouragement. However, the main three meanings in the New Testament are reflected in the Bible and also in some different versions by the three translations that we find of this word. we see this word is translated as the word comfort 23 times in the New Testament, as the word exhort 21 times. But then the word beseech, and it means to plead with or to implore someone, that one is used 43 times. Can you believe this? And we see that Paul declares in Romans 12, verse 1 and 2, and you know this scripture by heart. I've given you this scripture as a memory verse so often, that he says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Paul is pleading, he's imploring us to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God. And if you look at the previous chapters in the book of Romans, with so many great doctrinal truths, we see that Paul here implores the Roman believers to live a life that corresponds to those truths. But we also see him writing very similarly to the Ephesian church. In Ephesians 4 verse 1, he says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. He pleaded so fervently with two ladies in the Philippian church who were causing disunity that he uses this word parakaleo actually two times. In Philippians 4 verse 2, he says, I implore Euodia and I implore Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Twice he uses this word. We also see that there was serious disunity in the church at Corinth. And we see Paul writing to them in the book of 1 Corinthians 1 verse 10, where he says to them, Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions amongst you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Likewise, we see also Peter pleading with his readers in the book of 1 Peter 2 verse 11, where he says, Beloved, I beg, I beseech you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. All these instances of parakaleo and many more demonstrate the seriousness and the demand for the Christian walk, where it demands us to walk worthy of the call that we have received. Ephesians 4 verse 1, I therefore, Paul writing to the Philippian Ephesian church, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called. Paul challenges us as believers to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. In other words, we have to walk in balance to something. And the question then immediately arises, what then are we to walk in balance with? What is the counterbalance on the scales against what we measure? I don't know how many of you can remember the old scales. You had this one side that had weights that you could select the weight of what you want. On this side, there was a ball, and whatever product you are buying, you will put that in there until the scale balances. Now, Paul places us against this challenge. He calls us, or he challenges us as believers and as sons of God. And then he goes to 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 12, where he says, that you would walk worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. This is a very startling statement, because how can we balance the scales when God himself is the counterbalance? We certainly cannot compare ourselves with God in his nature, but we can balance the scales in our conduct and in our manner of life. That is why Peter could write that we are to follow his steps. In 1 Peter 2 verse 21, he says, for to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. John adds to this, and he says that we are to walk even as he walked. In 1 John 2 verse 6, it says, he who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. And how then, guys, do we do this? It's very simple. We walk after his commandments, his instructions. We walk according to his word. In 2 John 1 verse 6, it says, this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, that as you have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. And we come back again and we see Paul instructed Timothy and Titus that an important part of preaching is to exhort those who are in their care. Let me read to you again, 2 Timothy 4, verse 1 and 2. I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. And he says then in verse 2, he says, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. To Titus, he said in Titus 2 verse 15, speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. It is really my prayer that by now, each one of you listening and watching, listening to the audio or watching this video, will be under the conviction of the Holy Spirit, of the seriousness of how important this is for God, that we must walk and live from his word. I want to, in the last couple of minutes that I have, just present to you a couple of scriptures that I want you to study and look at how you can apply these scriptures in your life and in your walk with God. And I want to encourage you that as I give you the scriptures, that you write them down and that you note also what is it that the writer is actually imploring us as believers to do. The first one that I want to give to you is in Romans 15, verse 30. It says there, now I beg you, brethren, through the Lord Jesus Christ and through the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in prayers to God for me. Paul asked them, his sons, pray for me. And I want to ask you the same. Pray for me, pray for Renee, pray for us, for wisdom, for grace, for sensitivity to the Spirit of God, that we will clearly hear the voice of God in all assets and facets of our journey within the household. Romans 16 verse 17 says, now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. For me, personally, this was a very, very difficult word, because you have this scale that I have to balance. On the one side, I have to love my enemies. On the other side, I have to embrace those that do not believe in the same way that I do. And then, yeah, I find the scripture in Romans 16 that says, note those who cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which you have learned. And then it gives the instruction. It says, avoid them. As a direct result, I had removed some people off the WhatsApp groups, Facebook followers, the whole thing because of this. Because I have this conviction in my heart of how serious God is about his word. And as sons, I want you to carry that same urgency in your heart. Deal ruthlessly with anyone that opposes that which we carry and that which we believe. And please, with that, I'm not now saying go out there and bash people with the Bible. It's not what I'm saying. But separate yourself from those that carries a doctrine that is not accurate. Avoid them. In 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 9 and 10, it says, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. And indeed, you do so towards all the brethren who are all in Macedonia. But we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more. And I want to say to you, never be satisfied with the place where you are and the place that you have reached. There's always the following and the next dimension of what you can step into. 1 Timothy 5 verse 1, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers. So when this rebukes needs to take place, do it in love. And then there's Titus that speaks about leadership, verse 7 up until verse 11, and you know these scriptures. For a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convict those who contradict. For there are many insubordinate, both the idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things where they ought not, for the sake of dishonest gain. So you can see here Paul's perspective on this, in this letter that he wrote to Titus. And I encourage you to go and meditate on this, think upon this, and see how it applies to your specific situation and circumstances. The last scripture that I want to leave with you this morning is in the book of Jude, chapter 1, verse 3. It says there, beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. And I want to say to you as sons, almost like it's written here in the book of Jude, beloved, while I am very diligently making videos, audio recordings, sending notes concerning our common salvation, I have come to a place of finding it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was delivered to all of the saints. Be faithful in the word that you receive. Study it, meditate upon it. Those of you that have actually taken the time to really read and meditate on what I have been releasing, and also listening to some of Chada's messages and Doc's messages, you will realize that is basically a repetition of what has been said before, and just another angle, another way, another manner of life. And I pray that you see this, that I take the doctrine that I as a father receive from my father, I internalize it, and then I present it to you in a format in which I'm feeding you in turn. So don't see it as repetition. See it as your connection to the grace that you need to overcome, that you need to step into a deeper dimension in your personal journey and relationship with the Lord Jesus. It is my prayer that God will continue to bless you as you continue to pursue Him through His Word, the doctrine that we release, and that my prayer is that some part of this urgency that I am experiencing in my heart and my spirit towards each one of you, the sons, of how you need to embrace the doctrine that we are releasing in this time, that urgency will be imparted to you, and that you will begin to see and taste and experience that same urgency in your heart and in your spirit, and that you will begin to see and taste how the Word will begin to exhort you, to drive you, to deliver you, to protect you, to comfort you, to keep you safe in all aspects of your life. May the Lord Jesus bless you as you meditate on what I've shared with you this morning. And I really encourage you, and I cannot emphasize this enough, when I say to you guys, what I bring to you in one message is really, really just a skeleton. It's really just a seed of what God has given to me. It's just impossible to break it open to the level and the dimension where I examine every aspect of every scripture. That is your responsibility, because God works with each one of us individually. And each one of us individually is at a different place, a different position, different challenges that we are facing. But I can promise you that within what I've shared with you this morning, there's some part of what God wants to use to address your situation, your circumstances, your personal journey with Him. So may God grant you grace as you continue from here and meditate, apply, internalize His Word in Jesus' name. God bless you, and may you have a wonderful and a precious Sunday with your family. Great grace to all of you, and remember, we love you lots, and you are precious to us. God bless. Bye-bye.